on that. And indeed, these are sub applications that governments are now bearing pressure on. We've heard the housing minister basically lambasting local councils for not giving applications where they are, you know, relatively easy applications to give for all sorts of reasons, NIMBYism, whatever you want. So I just think, in the round, it's, I can understand why they've done the back of that field, and I've had it for a number of years. I've noted what the developer said in 2015 in the development of this plan. It's not something that's sort of just been rushed through. It seems to be long considered. And on all the issues that the residents and Mike were making representations on, the professional opinion is no objection. And Mike referred to Fire and Rescue, who have said no related planning comments on Fire and Rescue. So wherever we would go with this, in terms of reasons for refusal, I think it's very hard to defend our appeal, given the way this, the report's been written, and given the professional advice from the officers, I have to say, so I was reluctant when you upset residents and councillors who we have deep regard for, but my view is that it would be crazy, against all that we've sort of talked about in the past, just to refuse this. It fits all our criteria, and I think that would probably be out, but certainly, unless I hear something new, that unless I've heard now, we'll be moving towards recommendation of approval.
Thank you, Steve. David?
Yes, thank you very much, Chair. And having gone on the site visit, it was a well worth going on site. My first question of the officers, bearing in mind this is an outline application, it's not something where everything is located in specific places. My own perception from years of experience is that it did appear to be pretty slightly overdevelopment of the site. I know we can't change the application criteria. I'd have preferred to see something of the size of 6 dwellings here rather than 10. I just wanted to ask whether there was any density decision made on this site, whether what the density was compared with the density of the properties around it, because they all look to be slightly less dense than this development is going to be. That was the first point. And the second point was, can you confirm, as I think it's already said in the agenda, but for the benefit of people who are listening, the separation distances appear to have been met, and the overlooking seems to have been met. Assuming that technically all the criteria would normally apply have been met, other than my perception, it looks as though this site is a little bit overdeveloped. I'd just like the officers to comment on that fact. It does look overdevelopment compared with the other properties adjacent to it. Having said that, I fully endorse what Councillor Flowers has said. We need to build houses. This is residential land. It's scheduled for residential. It's not down as green belt or open green space or anything else. And we need to try and maximise the availability of that sort of land rather than encroaching on valuable green belt. No question about that. I would support that every time. So my only basic concern is whether it's just over development. And I'm interested to see what officers say about that in terms of density.
Thank you, through you, Chair. Prior to the NPPF, which is the National Policy Framework for setting out policies, there used to be in the planning, the OPPGs, it was stipulated that development had, well, on average, needed to be 50 dwellings per hectare. That now doesn't exist, so the National Planning Policy Framework, as it exists now, actually discourages planning authorities from stipulating densities, and we take a general wider view. Now, as has been pointed out tonight by the local board member and the petitioner, this area does benefit from quite large gardens. It's not unique at all throughout the rural. But there are developments that we do look at that have smaller gardens, and we use a guide now for a 10-metre garden, and this development, proposed development, does accord with that. So it's got adequate gardens. Yes, they're not as long as the gardens that bound the site, but that isn't in itself a reason to refuse it. There's no overlooking. It more than exceeds the usual 21 and 14 metres. The houses have a smaller footprint, it can be argued, to the houses that bound the site, but again, there's no restriction, there's no stipulation that they have to be a particular footprint. So overall, it's been assessed with the National Planning Policy Guidance and our UDP policies, so we don't consider that it's overdevelopment of the site.
for clarifying that.
Ian.
Thanks, Chair. Really interesting application to hear from the Mr. Hall and Councillor Sorgan. Just a couple of comments really, and a question for one of the officers. I understand that we no longer have to apply the rule regarding affordable homes on developments of 10 units or less. So clearly in this case, the applicant, having sensed that policy, has gone for 10 units, exactly 10 units on this site, in order to avoid the need to provide any affordable housing. Is that correct? Or is it correct that we need to apply affordable housing on this site?
Through you, Chair. The application came in 2015, so we wouldn't have applied that policy. The numbers anyway, it's changed. So it's 10 or more, but I'm not aware that there was anything. I mean, the application's presented as submitted. I'm not aware that there was any.
That's very clear. If it's 10 or more, and this application is for 10 units, should some of these be affordable?
Sorry, yeah, it's more than 10, so it's 11.
Right,
so,
okay.
Affordable.
In terms of the points that have been made about traffic from Councillor Sullivan and Mr. Hall, I accept the point about that Steve made in terms of planning officers interpreting policy. My concern is that we have so many policies now, it's almost difficult to decide which ones take priority in terms of what we're coming before the planning committee. I'm particularly concerned on this application. I didn't attend the site visits, but I did go down about 5:30 one evening. And my concern would be the cumulative impact of traffic on Covent East Drive. I found it difficult at 5:30 to drive down that road in surprisingly a fairly small car, an Astra. I couldn't get down that road easily. So to read in the report that there is adequate access and turning provision, particularly the point that Councillor Sullivan made about large vehicles, statutory vehicles that we have to provide, refuse vehicles. I'd be interested to know, are we absolutely sure that a refuse vehicle can get down that road and into this development to service the needs of the houses that we're about to possibly approve?
Keith, can I ask you that?
As I said, this road is proposed to be constructed to adoptable standards, so for this number of properties, the dimensions that are shown on the drawing actually comply with our adoptable standards. So if this road were to be constructed and we were requested to take it on as an adopted road as our responsibility, then we could do that. So in terms of what types of vehicles could go down there, then it's any type of vehicle that could go down any of our adopted roads, basically. So it's adopted road, or it's adoptable road. So I'm not certain if I can say any more than that, really.
I think the direct question is, could emergency vehicles on bin lorries go down that road?
They could, if nobody instructs them. It's the same as any other adoptable road throughout the borough. So in terms of coming up with a reason to object, then that's not a reason to object.
No, it's a good question.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, Stuart.
I'm assuming, first of all, we can't get the layout on the screen. So
we do have the layout, unfortunately. It's been scanned in. It's too faint to actually display.
I think having looked at it, and I know the members will look at it online, and the plan is normally a help of the site, so there's not been seen the plan. It did strike me, as it's obviously struck Councillor Sullivan, that it would have been difficult to get a bin lorry up and be able to perform within the site at a tear. To exit. It's that doubt that was in the back of my mind that we managed to try and illustrate with the plan. Thanks to David for putting out of it in outline. However, having looked at it, I see the only reserve matter in fact is landscaping. So everything else is really up for approval. Is that the case? Just on the subject then, sticking, if you like, with bin lorries, I've had regard to condition number 7, which I think is an unusual condition to put into an application that, despite the fact that it's listed as outline, so there may be reserve matters such as access is not in fact a reserve matter. So to have a condition that asks later, if you like, after the event, for the details for storage and disposal of refuge to be submitted by the applicant to the authority strikes me as odd. I think we need to be satisfied now, in fact, that storage and disposal of refuge and vehicle access thereto can be met. Because it strikes me that this condition has been put on by officers because we're not entirely certain, despite where the evidence is presented to us, that we can in fact do that. And I think, you know, as Councillor Sullivan has looked at the plan, I've looked at the plan, other members have looked at the plan. That doubt is in the back of my mind, as it's clearly in the back of somebody's mind, otherwise Condition 7 would not have been there. And I agree with David that, you know, at first sight, 10 on the site struck me as cramped and overdeveloped. And no doubts, if you like, are still there in the back of my mind.
Okay, thank you, Chair. Through you, condition 7 is a standard condition that we apply. Condition 7 is a standard condition that we use on almost all residential applications. So we don't always ask for that information up front. And what that condition aims to do is to demonstrate that there is room around the dwelling and its curtilage for actual storage of bins, which this development, clearly is, there's a driveway, there's garden areas. So it's to make sure that there's the space for all the relevant bins for each property. Now, the access arrangements are to show how a refuse vehicle can access the site, which Keith has already said, is it can access the adopted access road there into the site. And sometimes courtyard developments, backland developments, which do exist throughout the borough, they have a scheme where you put your bins out in a particular place. So this is the sort of detail that we would expect to see, and which we have seen on a lot of other developments, such as flat developments, you know, small mews, small terrace developments. So there is a way that the refuse bins could be stored for each property and could be brought out and collected in a usual way.
Okay,
yes, thank you, Chair. Just a few comments from me. I did also go on the site visit. Firstly, I note that under environmental and sustainability issues, it says there are no environmental sustainability issues related to these proposals, which, you know, having listened to the petitioner, maybe demonstrates how far we still have to travel in terms of adequately considering environmental and sustainability issues. One comment I would make, you know, the traffic is an issue. I think the cumulative impact is an issue, and I would just point out that this part of the world is not particularly well served in public transport terms. The difficulty, and it's, you know, certainly the lead petitioner would be frustrated about this, is what grounds might exist in planning terms to refuse this. And I think that's a struggle. If I look at the L shape of the plot, I look at the L shape kind of next door to it. It looks like a similar kind of level of development, notwithstanding the fact that when I was on site, I certainly formed the view that the applicant was, you know, maximising the number of units that could be accommodated on the site. Whether that necessarily means sufficient grounds to actually refuse this is another matter.
Okay, any other comments?
Right. Just a couple there, Chair, mate, without going over all ground. I mean, I understand the petitioners and their enthusiasm and passion, as was said before, Councillor Sullivan and I think it was the whole main petitioner, on a number of issues. But, you know, a number of the issues that were brought up, as far as I can see, have been addressed by the officers and are addressed in here. Certainly some of the colleagues who went on the site visit assured me on the issues. In terms of parking, I mean, Keith Rogers mildly said each one will have one parking space and one will have two, so 11 and all, you know, and I find it very hard to go against something like that, I really do. But I understand as well what Councillor Lewis said before, he said he drove up there, a small car, an Astra or something. So he doesn't drive, I understand that. But you said, didn't you, you found there was a problem with traffic in the area. But should they then tell us that it's in line with all the policies? And then one of the main issues with the petition was about the loss of habitat, bats, etc. And you know, in terms of that, I mean, we've got World Wildlife who I'm amazed who said there's no objection to this. And I would have thought they would have picked up on something like that. They're the experts that you know in terms of that. And of course Eric Bowman, the tree specialist who I'm sure we've all dealt with over the years and issues on our walks, you know, he says as well that he couldn't see any problems. And then we have the agents, and I don't know if it's a condition, the agent told us that a lot of the trees and habitats were being left in place, particularly in terms of screening. I'm a bit confused on that, but also at the same time, reassure that a lot of the habitats will be in place, and of course the bat boxes condition could be put in place, couldn't it, as well, to replace any loss of that habitat in terms of the wildlife. The only issue I have is possibly, and a number of members have mentioned it, is possibly overdevelopment, but again the officers reassured me on that, so but they're the issues I was looking at, Chair. Interesting to listen to all the comments from members. Thank you.
Okay, if there aren't any other comments, the officer's recommendation is to approve this subject to the conditions listed. Do we have a move on this?
Well, Chair, seeing as I started it off, I think just for public consumption, when Sad Javid and his edict say, you know, not my backyard. These are the actual one-to-one dilemmas that elected members face when they're trying to look for the housing numbers. You know, we've all been extremely polite. We've all examined all the issues that we thought you might be able to hook a refusal on. And I think I'm sensing none of us could be able to do that. So with that in mind, because I think it's important that the public understand the dilemmas that we face as well as elected members, as well as their passion for defending it. So, with those sort of comments in mind, I would, on behalf of the committee, move approval.
Denise, you second that. All those in favour of approval, subject to conditions listed.
It's not the ritual, though. This is.
Against.
Those who voted against, can we have a reason for refusal, please? We need a development.
told that that is all in order?
Correct.
Okay, so...
It could only be on the ground of public development, but I have to admit, I haven't met it. Coming to this meeting tonight and having gone to the site, my only reservation was about public development, but I have not come here with the intention of moving the feudal on those grounds. I thought maybe one of the other members would have to come up with that. I'm not the only support that would move the feudal, but I have not produced a wording for that presentation.
Inspector. The agents and the applicants are sitting there, just being up in time.
Well, they're saying they want me on to pick.
Kitchen facilities for the students that don't have a kitchen in the room.
games area, gym, which are sort of general communal areas. There's car parking proposed to the building. At the minute, the car parking is at the back of the site, adjacent to the residential properties, you can see in numbers 14 and 12. The proposal is to keep that area as a 24-space car park with access from Lord Street, slightly further south along Lord Street than it is at the moment. So you've got a central courtyard area, amenity space within the building. You've also got proposed amenity space to the east of the building, so that's between the building and the house. So another amenity area is proposed there. It's felt that this is quite a positive reuse of a building, a regeneration use within this particular area, and it's felt that it could be quite an asset to this part of Birkenhead. However, because it does back onto residential properties at the rear, it's important that we get it right and that any sort of loss of amenity or noise issues are dealt with at this stage. As such, the proposals have been amended through the lifetime so that we now have windows on the rear and side elevations. So that's the window, the elevation facing 14 and 12, and then the elevation alongside Maple House. So windows on the third floor of this have been changed so that they're oriel windows for single aspects, so they don't put all the properties. But the distance is pretty good to the existing properties. It's in the region of 25-28 metres, which is well within our normal parameters. Because of concerns about noise from use of the outdoor area to the east of the building, it's proposed that there is a management plan that we don't have the building is used. We know when there are any issues of noise, they're dealt with through the management proposals. And perhaps access to the area is restricted beyond a certain time. All these are covered through conditions that are on the report and also on the late list, which kind of beefs up some of the conditions. So on the basis of the proposal and the amendments to the proposal in terms of windows and extra conditions, it is recommended.
Thank you.
So
there is a qualifying petition for this. Is there a petitioner here to speak on this assembly? No. Is there a ward council that would like to speak on this? No. Can I open this up to committee, please?
Yeah, thanks, Cheryl. Just as it is in my ward. And I think members who are on the site visit will have seen, you know, the scale of this application. It's already a very large building. It's going to get significantly larger with an increased footprint and increased height of the building as well. So
Pat, can I just stop you there? As you've declared an interest, I take it that you have formed an opinion and you've been to this with an open mind.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
So that's a welcome aspect of the application. We're reusing an existing building. Compared to the previous application, the Royal Council wanted to demolish the building and create a car park. It's also very welcome in the sense that we are seeing a significant increase in the population in the local area around Hamilton Square. This would add significantly as well to that and bring an increased vibrancy and a younger demographic to the area. And it would be a welcome addition in terms of the aspiration to, you know, shift the centre of town back towards the traditional centre of Birkenhead. Now, again, on the site visit, people have seen that the building does back onto a significant number of residential properties, roughly about 100 properties. We'll be able to see this building from their front or back windows. So it's not surprising that residents have very legitimate concerns about the potential impact of the building. And in particular, I know the ones that they've raised have been the overlooking aspect, the noise aspect, and the fact that it is student accommodation only. Now, in fairness to the developer, they have, as the officer mentioned, there has been significant additional conditions imposed and changes to the application, which do improve things from the resident's point of view. The angle of the windows to the rear of the building have been changed to minimise any overlooking. I very much welcome that. There is a robust condition in terms of noise abatement and noise monitoring, and again, the applicant has indicated a willingness to monitor that very, very carefully. There is a management plan. I think that's crucial to the success of the project going forward, that the management plan is adopted and enforced robustly, and that the management of the building form very good relationships with the residents nearby. I think the one question I would have for officers is just to absolutely clarify that this application relates only to student accommodation, and if there was ever to be any change of use in terms of who was occupying the building, that that would require an additional new planning application.
Through you, Chair. Yes, that's correct. The use for student accommodation doesn't fall in the use class. It's a sui generis use. So to change to any other use, even any other residential use, would require planning permission.
Okay, any other comments? Sorry, Denise.
Yeah, no, I agree with Cass. I think this is an absolutely fabulous idea, especially where it is as well. Hopefully we generate the businesses in that local area and further afield, because obviously and then if people are coming from further afield, which obviously they will be now, and then their friends will come visit there. Hopefully it will become another tourist the way it used to be. Lots of people, vibrant businesses. Brilliant idea.
Okay, any other comments?
Yeah.
Steve?
Carry on, mate.
Now, I sort of read with interest, and initially, from what I'm reading here, it is to service our own growing university campus, albeit not fully fledged universities, but linked to universities, particularly Ironman and our Met College. But to me, it has real potential of actually being the start of something bigger. Because I never understood someone who's gone around looking at students' accommodation with children in the past, I never understood really why the river is seen as a barrier to, say, students at Liverpool University when they can equally live over this side and be in college within a minute or two. They've got the train to Hamlet Square, if it's a woman. But, you know, so but it needs to start, doesn't it? Students need to be part of the students. And Birkenhead needs a new dimension to its nightlife and to its daytime life. And students add that, they add that, as I think you referred to it, Pat, as they add that vibrancy, they add a different complexion. And I've been brought up in Birkenhead and gone out most Saturday nights in Birkenhead as a young man. It got very competitive, seeing the same faces all the time. And if you had an argument with one bloke, you'd had it for 6 weeks. You couldn't hide from them, you know. So it does need that sort of change. And you've seen the rise and fall of Market Street. When we tried to revitalise Market Street, it was the place to go. So perhaps this could be the beginning of something a little bit bigger. I understand the residents' concerns, and I actually think the development of the courtyard approach actually is a great idea, because most of the noise that it generated from that courtyard will reflect it on itself. So if it hadn't been altered into the courtyard, I'd been thinking about putting that design in itself. And we can all remember that building being full of council staff. Yeah. You know, it used to be the finance department and the benefits department. It was in there many, many occasions. So I just think it's good. And it sounds like we've got a developer who will talk to the community, will engage. And I think this could be really genuinely could be the start of something major for the town, Birkenhead, that I love and cherish. So good stuff.
Can I just say something, please, if it's okay? I did attend the site visit, and we met with a number of the residents on the site visit who clearly articulated that there were concerns, but those concerns had been met by the developer. So, on that basis, it made me feel a lot more comfortable about the application. Sorry, Denise, were you just about to move? Okay. So Denise has moved, Steve's seconded. All those in favour of approval, subject to the conditions listed and the additional conditions on the wait list. That's unanimous. Thank you.
Sound TV stored.
Okay, so we're going to move on now to. Sorry, can I just ask for those people who are still here, what applications are you here for? Okay, can I get.
11, agenda item 11.
Okay, anybody else here for any of the others? I'm just here as a notebook, Rob?
Eight.
Okay. Can I suggest then that we leave 6 for now and go to 8 and then 11 and then revert back? Is that okay? Okay, so we're going to take agenda item 8 next, which is 1 Charterhouse Church Street, which is pages 47 to 52. If we could have a presentation, please.
Thank you, Chair. This proposal is for floodlights on the 11-storey flats. And there's a total of 8 floodlights, 4 below the 6th storey on the north elevation and 4 more below the 9th storey on the south elevation. The flats have undergone recent renovations and they've been vacant for some time. So the floodlights, the idea behind them is intended to be part of the renovations to highlight all the work that's been carried out. The main objection to the illumination into the habitable rooms. There have been discussions with Environmental Health and the case officer on site with the residents to look at moving the position of the floodlights. And now I'm going to propose to face upwards instead of into, and it certainly should reduce any or alleviate completely any illumination or light pollution into the habitable windows. From that point of view, we've added conditions to the report to make sure that the lights are fixed in this position, and it's recommended approval on that basis, and there is a petition for objection.
Okay, is the lead petitioner here for this? Would you like to come forward, sir?
Please.
And if I could just ask you to state your name and address, please.
Yeah, my name's Chris Forager.
Can you put your microphone on?
Can
you
put your microphone on?
Sorry?
Sorry, what? Is it green or something?
I'm calling admission. So they all look great to me, those buttons. Thank you.
Okay, and just to let you know that you have up to 5 minutes, okay. And I will let you know when you have 1 minute left.
Okay. My name is Chris Forager. I live at 30 Palm Union Street, which is directly next to Charlton House. The floodlights proposed, first of all, clearly have no safety issue on them. It's you know, they're not there to create more safety around the practice. There is there's sufficient lighting for most street lights of Union Street and Church Street, and lights are around the flats there. So this brings us to the conclusion that Harper is an aesthetic point of view. As it also says in the document that we've been given here, so they are considered to have a positive impact on the appearance of the building and will help to provide a stronger sense of place and distinction. Unfortunately, this is not the view of the residents of the surrounding the Charter House. Most of whom commented when I went knocking on doors to raise this petition, commented that they've had enough of seeing the block in the daytime, would not want to see it at night time. The lights on the north side were operational for a single evening, used by many of the residents. When asked about their view of proposed floodlights, they were displeased, having seen them already look like working. Since the amendment, I have checked with those that are on the petition, and they still wish their names to remain, as they have them, and they still do not wish floodlighting whether pointing up or down. We did bring a visual representation of the petition. We brought that in with our petition, which does highlight that those that are signed completely surround the building. I've got a copy of that if you do wish to hear the copy. They completely surround Charter House, all those that signed. That only took me 3 hours to get those signatures. Only 3 people did not sign. One was elderly and didn't want to be bothered. One didn't speak English and wasn't fussy either way. I'm quite sure that had more residents been at home at the time, I would have had even more signatures to add to this, which would have completely surrounded that block of flats. As you've already said, we are concerned because myself, my wife and my children were in, and it completely illuminated our entire house. We had curtains shut and still lit up our house. Residents the other side of Union Street from the building also said that with their curtains shut, it still illuminated the inside of their house. We don't believe that light spacing upwards are going to change us too much because it will still illuminate off the building, which is, to be honest, is not something that any of the residents want to see. 2 years ago, planning permission was granted to demolish these flats. Every single resident was overjoyed. As soon as we heard that they were going to be renovated, there was dismay. Even with them, you know, looking better than what they were, no one wants to see them highlighted at night time. It's not something we want to look at. I have checked on many of the high-rise flats across the world. As a driver taxi, I'm all over the world. Most of them are not floodlit. So it's not about, you know, showing off the building. Most of the others haven't. The Cliffs Twin Towers over at New Brighton, massive prominent position, no floodlighting. The East Road Quay is a historical building, it's not floodlit at night time. So if these two prominent buildings aren't there to be shown off, then why should something in very close proximity to many houses be floodlit throughout the night, even early evening, many of whom have families, young children? It's not something that we are wishing to see.
Right,
thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there anything to say? Can I ask you to turn that microphone off, please? Thank you. Thank you. Okay, I'm going to have the ward council, so I'm going to open this up to committee. Thanks, Kurt. I give one advance to Steve. I'm going to have a
comment then to hear. Are you
happy to stay in the meeting? It's a problem with content property.
That's not the gents' application, is
it? No,
it's not. Let me clear. For the sake of safety, because I have had issues with people trying to cause trouble with my position on this planning committee, I will declare the interest and withdraw myself.
Right.
Okay.
Sure.
That in the most few years.
Tenants to a social landlord to have them renovated and put up the decent housing home standard. Once again, another block of social housing that's been flogged off by that developer, by that social landlord, because they couldn't afford to invest in that block and sold it off to a private developer. We now have the problems that Mr. Forrester has outlined. I listen to Mr. Forrester, and you know, sometimes you think, oh, it's going to be a NIMBY or somebody kicking off about a problem that is unreasonable. I have to say, having listened to Mr. Forrester, I wouldn't want to live next door to a block of flats that's permanently illuminated, particularly if you've got kids and if you're living literally underneath this block of flats. I know it quite well. I used to deal with leaflets around there. I know the problems that those flats caused in the past, but equally, I don't think we as a committee should really be giving such an easy ride to a private developer to illuminate these flats where we know it's going to cause a problem for people living there already.
Okay, anybody else? Kathy?
Yes.
I just want to concur with what Ian has said.